and is currently pursuing his master's from IIT Kanpur. And today he will be talking about perturbative and non-perturbative physics and instantons. So just a reminder, please do not ask your questions in the middle of the talk. If you have any questions, kindly put it in the chat box. Since there is a separate question answer session, I will come back to your questions when the question answer session comes. If you have a question during that session, please raise your hand and I'll come back to you. You can then unmute yourself and ask your question to the speaker. So over to Devopam and let's start.
Okay, thank you, Bulpayam. So I am audible, isn't it?
Please go ahead.
Okay, so the title of the talk is Perturbative and Non-Perturbative Physics and Instantons. And to begin this talk, I want to start with a quote. It is by Hans Bethe, a famous physicist. The quote is as follows. There are two types of genius. Ordinary geniuses do great things, but they leave you room to believe that you could do the same if only you worked hard enough. Then there are magicians who have no idea how they do it. So Feynman was a magician. And the reason why I'm talking about Feynman is because the whole talk is based on something which Feynman did. So one comment before starting is there may be some non-trivial calculations which I will skip in this talk. But if somebody is interested, then maybe after the talk, they can tell me about which part of the calculations they need. Then I can send him or her the part of the calculations. But maybe the calculations are a bit long, so they will take a lot of time. So to begin with, first I will talk about path integral and what is the general idea of path integral and the way we can use the path integral in order to solve free particle and harmonic oscillator with an external source. So from quantum mechanics, we know that from the definition of transition amplitude, that in the Heisenberg picture, if we write the transition amplitude in quantum mechanics, then it is of the form as in equation one. So we know this from quantum mechanics. So now if I divide this time interval from say T naught to T into n equal parts, and at the end of the calculation, if I take n tends to infinity, then we can modify this formula and can obtain something interesting. So we can modify this formula and from the use of completeness relation and introducing coordinate basis states in between this bra and this ket, we can introduce coordinate basis states and use the completeness relation to obtain this transition amplitude in this format. And after obtaining this, we can see that there are some integrations over this coordinate variables like x1 up to xn minus 1, and there are integrations over p1 up to pn. So, and there is a e to the power, some phase factor is over here. So over here, if we take epsilon as common, if we take this epsilon outside, then there will be an epsilon divided in the denominator of this term, and this epsilon will go outside. So we take epsilon tends to zero and n tends to infinity. So if epsilon tends to zero, then this term where in the denominator there is the epsilon, that term will be p x dot minus this Hamiltonian part. So it is I by h cut integration ti up to tf. This integral, this summation will convert into integral and it will be over dt. So this part is obviously, again, from classical mechanics, we know it is Lagrangian. So this phase factor can be transformed into this form as it is mentioned in equation 3. So here the Hamiltonian, which we are talking about, we will take a specific case, we will take a specific form of this Hamiltonian, but the result that we will obtain, it is valid for any form of Hamiltonian. So I will mention why it is valid for any form of Hamiltonian. You can actually see the result and you can predict yourself only that it is valid for any form of Hamiltonian. So if you start with the specific form of Hamiltonian, then putting that Hamiltonian in that equation, in the specific form, we can obtain this type of, after few calculations, because you can see that P integrals are done over here. So those P integrals will be Gaussian integrals. So if you evaluate those Gaussian integrals, then you can find the form of the phase transition is form of the transition amplitude is this. So if I write this in the specific form as like the whole integration, it is the action. So if I transition amplitude in the shorthand notation, I can write like this. This is the famous Feynman's path integral formula. This dx over here, it is basically the multiplication of dx1 up to dxn minus 1. So in the shorthand notation, it is written as this curly dx. So as I told that this form is valid in general and not depending on the specific form of the Hamiltonian, because that in the general, in this ultimate form of this formula, the action appears in the exponential part and not any specific form. Like, although we took this specific form and wrote the action, but since the action appears over here, so we can now use this and go back for any specific form of the form we want. If you want to go back from here to this form, then we can do that. If some other form of Hamiltonian is present, then we can write the action for that form of Hamiltonian. So what is the physical meaning of this type of very complicated formula? Because as you can see that there are n minus one integrals that needs to be done, and then you have to evaluate this action, and then you will obtain something called the transition amplitude. So what is the physical significance of this whole formula? So the physical significance is that we started with the two endpoints fixed, like over this diagram. In this diagram, it is x naught and xn is fixed. We are integrating from x1 up to xn minus 1. So we divided this whole region into very small parts. So if I integrate this x1 up to xn minus 1, these all the variables, then you can imagine that we are actually taking, suppose this small part, then this small part, then this small part, like this we are going. So basically we are doing from starting from this initial point up to this final point, we are actually summing over all the parts that is present from x0 to xn. Now this is completely contrary to what we obtain in classical mechanics, because we know that in classical mechanics that x0, if the initial point is x0 and the final point is xn, then there is a specific classical path. But in quantum mechanics, what Feynman is doing, that he is telling that we need to sum over all the paths that is connecting that initial and final point. So that is the physical significance of this integration dx, because here we are integrating over all the variables. Now there is another factor, obviously, this e factor. So each of the path that we are integrating, we are weighting it by some factor e to the power I by h cut s of x. Now this weight, as you can, in the next point I will show you that this weight is in classical mechanics, this weight is absent, obviously, because there is only one path and that is connecting the initial and the final, and that is a classical path. So this weight, so in the classical limit, as in all the cases in quantum mechanics, we can take this h cut tending to zero and we can obtain this classical limit, or we can predict what is the classical results by taking this limit. It means it is not exactly right maybe to pointing out this h cut tends to zero because it is a physical constant, but we can obtain predict what is the classical result from the quantum result by taking this limit. So if I take this limit h cut tends to zero in the denominator, then obviously this factor is very large, and to obtain a constant means extremum value, we need to take the extremum value of sx. So if we take the extremum value of sx, you know the action principle of classical mechanics, it states that we need to extremize the action, obviously. So you can also see that from the Feynman's path integral formula that there is a notion of action principle. So another thing is that from the classical, suppose there is a classical path over here also, there is a classical path that we will obtain in this limit, and the neighboring path of that classical path, the very nearby path, that will differ only by a very small factor from the classical path. So that factors will actually add up to this transition amplitude. Those will contribute, they will coherently contribute to this transition amplitude. But the paths which are very far away, or which are quite far away from this classical path, obviously this quite needs to be defined, because in physics you need to give proper approximate proper estimates. So you can we can estimate that what is exactly the limit from where we can consider this possibility. From there, since h cut is very small, the small difference of action will change this phase by a lot of by a huge factor. And the integration over those paths will not contribute to this transition amplitude. So in this classical limit, you can see that we from this Feynman's path integral, we can actually get back the classical path. So this is not something totally different from classical mechanics or the results we cannot obtain. This is another advantage of path integral because it is very near to the classical results. Means we can obtain the classical results from Feynman's path integral formula, or we can actually predict it at most, like we can predict the results. So the next topic is we obtain the Feynman's path integral. This is the main formula. And from here, we need to show some calculations to evaluate free particle and harmonic oscillator with an external source. So for free particle, first we will take free particle because this is much easier than harmonic oscillator with an external source. So for the free particle, we can write the Lagrangian over here. So if we put the Lagrangian over, or if we calculate the action for this Lagrangian, then we will obtain something mx dot square. And for the free particle, x dot is constant. It is xf minus xi divided by tf minus ti. And if we put that xf minus xi divided by tf minus ti whole square, and there will be another factor of delta t, like tf minus ti over here, that will cancel the 1 power of tf minus ti. And we obtain something like this, the transition amplitude. So I will state many results without showing exact detailed calculations, but I will try to convince you that by some physical check that these results are very physical, actually. Like over here, we can do a physical check over here. What is the physical check? Suppose we take the two times TF and TI to be equal or approaching each other. So you can imagine a situation where there is a free particle. It is going from one point XI to XF at time TI to TF, but we are telling that TI to TI and TF is approaching each other, or TF is approaching TI. So you can imagine that this is only possible for a classical free particle if those two points XI and XF are at the same point. And if it is not the same point, then there is no meaning actually in this limit. So we expect, and we know from mathematics or physics, that there is one type of function which takes this thing into account, and that is a delta function. So this transition amplitude goes down to this delta function, and you can take this limit and you can obtain the delta function in this algebraic form, and you can see that a limit TF approaching TI, and you can see that this is actually the delta function, this transition amplitude. So physically this is possible, physically this result is correct. I'm not talking exactly about these factors because those may differ, and you have to do the exact detailed calculations for calculating these factors, but the overall structure of this result is correct. So these physical checks I will give after every formula, because I am not able to show these exact detailed calculations of these formulas. So this is one physical check. Also, you can do another thing. Now we started with something called transition amplitude from quantum mechanics. And the thing that we obtain is obviously quantum mechanics, it is based on quantum principles of quantum mechanics. So what we know from basic quantum mechanics is our Schrodinger equation. So we should obtain this from here, we should obtain back the Schrodinger equation. So if I take the first derivative with respect to time, and the second and two derivatives, so second derivative means two derivatives with respect to xf, you can actually see that we can obtain the Schrodinger equation for free particle, that is the potential part is zero. So this part, this transition amplitude brings back our Schrodinger, well-known Schrodinger equation. So the formalism that we did in quantum mechanics, that is at par with this Feynman's path integral, and it is not predicting some very different results from that. It is giving back our known results already. So free particle is somewhat easier, but harmonic oscillator with an external source now. So harmonic oscillator with an external source, this Lagrangian is defined like this. There is a source term over here. For evaluating this, you can see that the action which we evaluated very easily in case of free particle in the exponential, this phase factor, here the action will not be evaluated, cannot be evaluated so easily. So to evaluate the action, we will take a path, we will take a classical path and take some variation with that path and obtain a total path. So if I take something like this, if we take the path as some classical path, some plus some variation, so the our action will be some classical action portion, and from this variation there will be another term. So that term will be something of this form. So if I put this everything into Feynman's path integral formula, our Prime-Mann formula, then and convert, there was del dx. So dx1, dx2 is a multiplication of those. Now I change the variable to d eta. And because of changing the variable, the remaining, the Jacobian will be absorbed in this A. And I can take out this classical path, classical action portion from here. And the remaining portion is this variation of the path, the action from the variation of the path. So now this integral is again very non-trivial. Now to evaluate this integral, there are two methods, the method of Fourier transform, first one, and the matrix method. So the method of Fourier transform, you can take eta to be summation over n an sine n pi t divided by capital T, and you can proceed with the calculations by putting it over here. And I will actually at the end of the talk, I will tell you some reference where you can find these exact detailed calculations, or where you can find the more detailed explanations about path integral. And there is another method called matrix method. So eta is again taken to be a column matrix as eta 1, eta 2, and there will be some Gaussian integrals in terms of these matrices. So you have to evaluate those, or you have to find the general formula for those Gaussian integrals, and then you can use those Gaussian integrals to evaluate this integral, to evaluate this result. Remember, there are many integrals, not one. Like from d eta 1 to d eta n minus 1. So the I'm not showing the exact steps, but the exact formula is after you do the formula calculations, the formula is obtained like this. So over here again, you can see that there is a e to the power I by h cut s of xcl, like we obtained for our free particle case, same thing. But the factor will be different. There is omega divided by sine omega t over here, which is unlike that of free particle. So now there is another term which is not known to us. That is this portion, this classical action, that is also not known to us. We evaluated this part, but we did not comment anything about this classical action. Now to evaluate this classical action, you need something called Green's function, because you know that to evaluate the differential equation, inhomogeneous differential equation, we need Green's function. And there are three types of Green's function you can talk about. The one is advanced, retarded, and Feynman's Green's function. Now Feynman's Green's function is something of, means a special type of, it's a type of mixture of advanced and retarded. I will show you why. So you can, here we will use the Feynman's Green's function. So again, Feynman's Green's function is of this form. Why this form is there for Feynman's Green's function? It needs some explanation actually, why this form is there, and you need to go through the differential equation portions of about why this form is there actually. So for the Feynman's Green's function, the contour is like this. So for evaluating complex integrals, we know that we can do it in two ways. One is that we can, if there are poles on the real axis, one is that we can take a contour like this, or another way is we can take the contour over the real axis and we can shift these poles up and down. So here we will follow this second process. Okay, so here if I break this portion into two parts, if this portion into two parts, we will get k plus omega minus I delta, k minus omega plus I delta. So over here, epsilon and delta obviously are related, and you can multiply this and check the relation. And you can see that one is, this is a minus I delta, it is moving down, and plus I delta is moving up. For the retarded and advanced Green's function, for the retarded, it is both up, and for advanced, it is both down. So we will use Feynman's Green's function. And using this Feynman's Green's function, you can see that we obtain the classical action as very complicated formula, unlike the previous case of a free particle. Here there are many terms. There are four integrals that is not exactly evaluated actually. Three integrals not exactly evaluated. But again, I want to give some physical check whether this result is physically acceptable or not, I'm not showing the detailed calculation. You can see that if I take JT to be zero, these three terms are gone. And if I take the omega to be zero or omega approaching zero, then in the Lagrangian, we can obtain the free particle, and we can check that this action, classical action, gives us our previously known free particle action. So, classical action. So over here, so if I put this whole action, classical action over in this formula in equation 13, then the result that we obtain is the transition amplitude in the case of harmonic oscillator with an external source. So this is how we can actually use this path integral to obtain a free particle and to evaluate this external harmonic oscillator with an external source. Now I want to talk about the correlation function. Hello. What is correlation? Yes.
Yes, Devam.
Tell.
Can you please repeat the slide? Just the previous slide.
This one?
Yes. So what is the minus EP or plus EP in the contour?
Excuse me, I might just interject, Akashdeep, but I think we have the question answer session at the last. So can you just write your question in the chat box? I'm sorry.
Okay, sorry.
Devam, please continue.
Okay. At the end, I will answer that question. Okay. So here we will tell about what is correlation function. This correlation function is what is correlation function and how we can evaluate this correlation functions and why we are interested in this correlation functions at the first place. So in the quantum mechanics, we deal with three pictures. We deal with Heisenberg picture, we deal with Schrodinger picture, and in quantum field theory, there is another picture which is known as the interaction picture. So here, when there is H, it means that we are talking about Heisenberg picture. There is a basic difference between these pictures. Like in Schrodinger picture, the state is dependent on time, but the operators are time independent. In Heisenberg picture, the state is independent of time and the operators are dependent on time. And in the interaction picture, both the operators and the states are dependent on time. So here in this case, But the interaction picture has its own use, although both are dependent on time, but in quantum field theory, there's a huge use of this interaction picture. So for the Heisenberg picture, we are taking this Heisenberg picture. And from the transition amplitude is basically this left hand side in Heisenberg picture. So how can we evaluate this type of quantities where there are two operators and it is sandwiched between this type of ket and bra, and how can we evaluate these type of quantities? And for the time being, I'm taking this ordering, like TF is greater than equal to T1, greater than T2, greater than equal to TI. So to evaluate these type of quantities, we need something called time ordering operator. So what is time ordering operator? So time ordering operator is, since we are taking T1 greater than T2, so here there is a step function T1 greater than T2, and this part of the time ordering operator will remain, and this part will be zero. If I take the inverse, like T2 is greater than T1, then this part will be zero and only this part will remain. So actually we are depending on T1 and T2, we are ordering the operators, like in which order those operators will act on this ket and maybe this bra also. So for this, we can generalize this formula. We can generalize this formula and go to n operators like this. And this T is denoting this time ordering operators, like time ordering products of this. So we can, after generalizing this, we can write this from this primary formula. We can write all the operators will come down over here, and those other things, other factors will remain as it is in equation 16. So to evaluate this type of, the expectation values of these time ordered operators, we use this general formula. So this general formula can be derived, like it is not falling from the sky, or we are not defining anything over here. We can evaluate this expectation values by using this general formula, which can be derived and which can be found in all the texts on path integral. So you can look up into this derivation, how this general formula is, we can evaluate this, how this general formula is coming. So over here, I will explain the terms. This is called the generating functional. So we are taking nth order derivatives of this generating functional with respect to the source terms at T1, T2 up to Tn. And at the end of the calculation, we are taking J equal to zero. But remember that this is not the derivation differentiation we know actually, because here there is a source term. So J and T1, J and T2, those, these are functions. Means these are already, these are functions. So we need to fit in these functions. And here, this variable is actually T. So the differentiation over here is functional differentiation, not the ordinary differentiation. So you can read more about functional differentiations, how we can evaluate these functional differentiations. So as I told that, this is called the generating functional. So we will work in the Heisenberg picture unless I put, means unless I explicitly state, and I'm not putting this H index over in all the cats and girls. So we are interested in the vacuum functional. Vacuum means here we will start with the zero cat and we will end in the zero bra. So we are interested in the vacuum functionals because from that vacuum functionals we can actually create in quantum field theory all the particles that we need. Like one particle state we can create, two particle states we can create. So we are actually interested in the vacuum functionals, then we can create the particle number of particle states we want to. So for the vacuum functional, and there is a J over here, J the source term. So we are explicitly mentioning this bit because this is a source term that we are using. And this part is the Lagrangian plus the source term I'm writing separately over here. And taking the time to be minus infinity to plus infinity. That means we are taking the means whole domain of time over here. So you can see that minus infinity to plus infinity is also over here. It was not previously mentioned because we did not state which limit of time we are taking. So over here now, there is something called adiabatic switching. And adiabatic switching means we can switch on the source terms on and off. So we will take minus tau and plus tau and take tau to be infinity. And we do this mainly for the convergence of the integral. And there are other reasons why we do this adiabatic switching. So we can define vacuum functional as something like this. From the previous formula only, this will follow. And there is another term called J, effective action, which is Wj, and it is minus I h cut natural log of Z of J. So I showed an example of you over here, like how this derivative is done and what is the formula that we obtain in terms of the time ordered operators. So you can carry out this derivative and obtain this result. You can check yourself this. So here this effective action is important because we need to know something called connected Green's function. These connected terms arise from the Feynman's diagram. Maybe I cannot talk about Feynman's diagram over here because I cannot finish that talk then. We can take a talk about connected Feynman diagrams, disconnected Feynman diagrams, and what are the uses of those, and how this Z of J is related to statistical mechanics. Because this all, this path integral is very closely related with statistical mechanics. We can obtain the partition function from over here, and we can then derive the statistical mechanics properties from that partition function. So it is called link cluster theorem, and you can see how this this connection is established from this path integral thing. The next thing that I want to talk about is the anharmonic oscillator. So this anharmonic oscillator is very important to us. Like in quantum mechanics, we need to deal with this anharmonic oscillator because in quantum field theory, there is something called lambda phi-4 theory. So for dealing with that lambda phi-4 theory, we need something like phi-4, like x-4. We need something, a term like this. So it is very closely related to quantum field theory. So lambda phi-4 theory to be more precise. So here also, this is a perturbation to the harmonic oscillator, the anharmonicity part of this. And to evaluate this, we again introduce some source term J of X over here, and the Lagrangian remains as it is. So we explicitly mention this J over here. So this Z of J is the generating functional, as I told, and generating functional is this. So we can split this action into two parts. This S naught X of J, which is the excluding this part, and the separate part of this perturbation from this, because lambda we will take very small, means very small with respect to one. And this S naught of X comma J is this part from this one, two, and fourth term. So from here, you can take this derivative functional, again, remember functional derivative, and you can obtain X of T. So we can notice one thing, that when we are taking a functional derivative with respect to J, we are obtaining something called X. So whenever we can replace this X by taking the number of functional derivatives. So over here, I will do the same thing, like del del jt can be replaced by X of t. The operation gives the X of t. So here I will do the same thing, like I replace this, because there are four powers, I replace it by del del j of t to the power four. And the rest of the parts is from the Green's function considerations. I can write the rest of the parts to be in this form. Like Green's function is there over here. This is the Feynman's Green's function because of the term f. I explicitly mentioned it over here, Feynman's Green's function. And there is a z naught zero part. That z naught zero part is like if I take the source term to be zero. So this part does not include the source term. So this part does not include the source term. This part includes the perturbation, and this part explicitly includes this source term, as you can see. The exact form, again, you need to do a bit of calculation to see the exact form of this this exponential. I know it is a bit non-trivial, but you need to do a bit of calculation to see the exact form. So now I move to something. So I will keep this generating functional, this form over here. And I moved to something called imaginary time and Euclidean time. Like we were dealing the things in UK in Minkowski space and using Minkowski's time. And now we need to do something called Euclidean time. Euclidean time, we now define tau is equal to it. And from here, you can see that I is gone. This imaginary I, iota is gone from here. And this v of x, it becomes positive because we know that in Lagrangian, it is minus of v of x, but here it is positive. These things will be taken into consideration for something called instantons. So here I am taking specific limits, like we are taking minus I beta x 0, 0, x. This we need to evaluate this transition amplitude in this, like it is tf, xf, ti, and I am taking same. So, and here tau is there because it was initially dependent on t. So for evaluating this, why we do this Euclidean time? Because we don't want the integral to be oscillatory like in case of Minkowski. There was a term called I. So it makes the integral very oscillatory, and we have a problem dealing with that. So we take into this Euclidean time. So you can see the limits and you can put the limits over here. And this function, this part, this action is called the Euclidean action. And I do, again, I explicitly mentioned this E part over here, Euclidean action. One thing, again, I will mention is that potential term is reversed. Potential sign is reversed, not potential term, potential sign is reversed. So from partition function into statistical mechanics, we know that we define the partition function as summation e to the power minus beta energy into E. So from there, we in the limit beta tends to infinity, we can see that the ground state will contribute the most, like ground state energy will contribute the most. So we take this ground state energy to be contributing the majority of this partition function in this limit, and we can obtain this ground state energy formula to be like this. Here the partition function is there, z. It is from statistical mechanics, clearly from statistical mechanics. And the propagator, now the propagator, as we wrote in the Heisenberg picture, we can convert into the Schrodinger picture. You can look up into quantum mechanics book about the conversion of these pictures, and we can convert. We wrote in the Heisenberg picture. Now we convert this into the Schrodinger picture, and because of the conversion, there is a factor, exponential factor over here. So another thing is that so we can do all the things for anharmonic oscillator. We can take this Euclidean action. We can write the Euclidean action in terms of, you can see the signs are reversed. You can see the signs are reversed over here. I is gone. So we can write the Euclidean generating functional for the anharmonic oscillator. So this is a Euclidean action. And since we are taking the lambda to be very small, we are limiting ourselves to the first order of lambda, and the higher orders will not be considered over here. So there are, you can actually see the calculation of this anharmonic oscillator of the ground state energy in a paper called Bender and Wu. I will tell you in the reference. And there in the calculation, you can, they have explicitly shown the calculation of this ground state energy. For the time being, take this result to be true. Okay, for the time being, take this result to be true. But I can give you a physical check for this result. Take lambda to be zero. Okay, so for first term is gone. All the higher terms are gone. Half of h cut omega. So without perturbation, we know that this result is true. For the harmonic oscillator ground state energy, this result is true. So you can see that this result is passes one physical check. So you can look up this Bender and Wu. There is an algebraic method that is shown, and it is from the time independent Schrodinger equation. They can actually calculate this exact the first order correction. So means we from the perturbation series also we can calculate this first order corrections. And here I am talking about this lambda tends to zero, and you can check that this is correct, this formula. And so there might be a question that why we are using perturbation, why we are not using perturbation theory, and why we need to bring so much complications, because here the calculations are much more complicated. The reason for using path integral instead of perturbation theory is because the first order may be easier for perturbation theory, but the higher orders and for other systems, the path integral is much more general and much more easier to calculate than perturbation theory. The higher orders in perturbation theory is like very complicated. Means it is very complicated to calculate. So we obtained this series very good. This series is it is satisfying our physical check, but there is something very non-trivial about this series. The terms are it is non-perturbative series. Why it is non-perturbative series and how to deal with non-perturbative series? First I will tell, and then I will tell you at the end of this section that why it is non-perturbative. So it is Borel summation. We will define something called Borel summation. When the series is non-perturbative, then suppose we want to sum over this. We want a series like this, where n grows much faster than as the powers of n. So Euler summation is not applicable. So we define something like this, where we divide it by n factorial, and we define the Borel summation and like this. This is the definition of Borel summation. And Bx is basically the summation over n equal to 0 up to infinity, an x to the power n. Now to bring our result back to our original series, we will take x is equal to zero, x equal to 1. So if I take x equal to 1, b of 1 will give us our original series. And all these things will actually have some meaning and actually have some mathematical background. I will again give you in the reference section, I will give you a reference where the whole book is about this asymptotic series. So there is a huge background behind this asymptotic series or Borel summation or generalized Borel summation, Euler summation. There are many types of summations defined like this. So this formula is defined, and why it is defined like this, you can read up from that book. So the ground state perturbation series that I showed over there in the previous slide, over here, this perturbation series. So the ground state perturbation series, I can write in this formula, a general series. There are some notation over here because a I took 1 and omega tending to m. Because this is the notation that is used in Bender and Wu, and I thought that if you want to follow that calculation, this notation might be easier. So if you take the m equal to 1 and omega tends to m, you can obtain the previous formula that I showed in the third slide. So only these two conversions you need to make. So over here, the asymptote of this an. Asymptote means in the large n limit, what is the form of this an we can obtain. So the asymptote is this. In the Bender and Wu, they calculate up to n equal to 75 terms, and they obtain the asymptote as in this expression. You can see that the expression involves many things. Like there is a gamma, and there is a 3 to the power n gamma function. There is a 3 to the power n. This is an oscillating series. So the asymptotic series is not very, very, very easy over here. So how Bender and Wu obtained that? I will tell you that. So there are two series, like there is an plus 1 and an. So you can take the ratio. They calculated these ratios, and they obtained this ratio as this, an plus 1 by an. And from there, they predicted that if we take an to be like, just suppose we take an to be like this. So an plus 1 by an is of this form. But this is obviously not the exact formula because we don't know the higher and higher orders. So we will multiply some perturbation series with this, because 1 by n, although I told you perturbation series, but we will see whether it is actually perturbative or not. So 1 by n, we will multiply 1 by n square. So we will take this series and try to find out these coefficients. So how to find out these coefficients? we will take n equal to 75 minus k, 75 minus k minus 1, like this we will go on, and we will terminate this series at some point, and we will obtain many different we will obtain many equations here in terms of a naught, a1, a2, like this. For maybe 75 equations we will obtain, and we can solve those equations by taking difference. Actually, this should be difference equations. We can, this is not differential. This is difference equation. We can solve those equations and find out these coefficients over here. So for that coefficients, if we do the calculation, then we can find out a naught to be like this, a1 by a naught to be like this, a2 by a naught to be like this, a3 by a naught to be like this. One thing you can note that this is increasing continuously. This is increasing. So with respect to a naught, a1, a2, a3, these are all the terms are increasing. So this is actually not something called a convergence series. This is actually diverging. So you can calculate higher orders, and you can see that these terms are increasing very rapidly. But one can argue that there is an n factor over here. So maybe these terms are converging, but you can check that even these terms are also not converging. You can check that by putting explicit values of n. So the E naught function that we obtain, that is the ground state in terms of the perturbation, means this parameter lambda, perturbative parameter lambda, we can obtain the ground state to be in this form. This function is this. This functional form of this is this integration. So here the lambda is obviously there. We can do this by using this Borel summation technique that I showed in the previous slide, and you can obtain the same result that we obtained in the case of this one. You can obtain this series exactly using Borel summation. So the thing that I talked about, Borel summation, is actually giving you the results that we need. Actually, we obtained already from our maybe perturbation series or maybe from the Feynman's path integral. So instant terms, how can we talk about instant terms? What is instant terms? So instant terms is something that will arise from double well potential. So if there is a potential like this, this is a double well potential, and you can write the action like this. From minus T by two, the time limit I have set, although I have set the time limit, but I will make some comments about this time limit. So we again go to the Euclidean space and make this transformation. And if we go to
Debogom, you have 10 minutes left.
Okay, sure. So if I go to the Euclidean space, I will obtain something like this. In the Euclidean space, I will obtain this action as like this. So from the action principle, I can obtain from this, if you use the Euler-Lagrange equation, I can obtain the solutions as x is equal to plus minus a. So the corresponding Euclidean energy is this. Means from here only you can tell the corresponding Euclidean energy is this. And I told you that in the Euclidean space, if we make the Euclidean transformation, then the potential is reversed. So the actual potential is actually in the upper axis, in the positive axis, but because we are dealing in the Euclidean space, we are actually the potential is getting reversed, and it is called the double humped potential. These are the two my solutions, minus n plus n. So the classical solution is that the particle will stay at the two hills, the top of the hills, with the this x dot will be zero for x is equal to plus minus a, and this part will be zero because if you put here, there, so the Euclidean energy will be zero. So one classical solution is that you can place the two particles at the top of the hills, or a particle at the top of the hills, and you can obtain one classical solution. The corresponding solution in the Minkowski space is that it will be in the bottom of the well, and there you can use the simple harmonic oscillator arguments, and in the quantum version, you can use that solution for the same in the Minkowski space. Another solution is this. You can put it into the Euler-Lagrange equation and check that this is a solution of the action principle of the Euler-Lagrange equation. So here from the tan hyperbolic function, we can get at the two limits of minus infinity and plus infinity as plus minus plus a plus minus a. And if I plot this solution over here, then we will obtain these two graphs, because that the nature of tan hyperbolic is like hyperbolic function is like this. This solution is called instanton, and this is anti-instanton solution. So the solutions are itself called instantons and anti-instantons. So you can see that the physical description of the solution is, therefore, particle starts out at minus a at t is equal to minus infinity, then it is found at or move over to plus A, another hilltop at t is equal to plus infinity. So we need to calculate the transition amplitude of this and vice versa, the transition amplitude for the vice versa case. So the Euler-Lagrange or Euclidean Lagrangian is this. You can plot the, you can actually calculate the Euclidean Lagrangian from the previous Lagrangian and you can obtain this form. And from here, if you plot the Euclidean Lagrangian, the sec hyperbolic function to the power 4 is a function like this, and it is a localized Lagrangian, and the difference over here, like in the standard deviation we do, it is 1 by omega, and it is root over of m divided by ga. So we obtain something called a localized solution over here. So the instant term solution are localized in time and also has a physical significance of TC, because it is the time at which the solution reaches the value of the Euclidean potential over here. The value over here, it is the time over here, the value, it will reach the value at TC. And also TC has another significance, that is, it denotes the time, translational invariance of this whole solution. Like we can, because TC arises from the integration constant, and we can denote the time translational invariance. And there is a steepest descent you can do, method of steepest descent, and we'll obtain the transition amplitude in the case of instantons to be a part of transition amplitude of the harmonic oscillator and the contribution from the instanton, where R is defined to be like this. You can go through the calculations. You can go through the calculations and obtain this form. So harmonic oscillator times contribution from instantons. So anti-instantons also, we can introduce this, obtain the same result and same transition amplitude we can obtain. So the results and conclusions. So Feynman's path integral is a very elegant way, and it's a much more generalized way and much more close to quantum field theory, and where we can use it to evaluate the non-abelian gauge theories in quantum field theory. And I could not show the Feynman diagrams. It can follow from the statistical mechanics from that slide, we can follow the Feynman diagrams. And the Bender and Wu paper, you can go up to higher terms, like above 75, and you can see, you can obtain better asymptotic resolution of AN. And you can read about this summation of divergent series, what we exactly mean by summation of divergent series, and what we can extract from those results of summation of divergent series. And we can go further development of the multi-instanton solutions also, not only single instantons. And you can read about how we can, and what is the physical significance of these multi-instanton solutions. Okay, so with this, I would like to end the talk, but I will state some few references you can look over here. This advanced mathematical methods, this is the asymptotic methods and perturbation. This is a whole book on this asymptotic methods and perturbation theory. And this Feynman, this is the original paper of Feynman, where he first introduced this path integral, 1948. This is the Bender and Wu paper you can look into, the calculations that I am talking about. This is Kleiner, this is a very fat book, 1,500 pages book, where almost everything is there in path integral. So you can look at this Kleiner book. It means you have to find a bit about the calculations. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Devupam. So that was a really interesting session. So I'll quickly go over to the questions. So Akashdeep is still here. So Akashdeep, you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Oh. Akashdeep, okay. So I think he has written the question already in the chat box. Okay, I'm so sorry. Yeah. Akashdeep, yeah, go ahead.
Yes, so my first question was that you have mentioned, Devupam, you have mentioned the term like, as a prefactor, it appears 1 over epsilon to the power n, something like that.
1 over epsilon?
To the power n, in very previous slide.
In the more previous?
As a prefactor.
Prefactor. With, in which case actually means in the path integral idea or
yes, more two slide ago most probably one slide ago. Yes, so in the limit in the second point you have mentioned about some 1 over epsilon to the power n, so
1 over epsilon to the power n capital N.
So something only if I consider only this prefactor, it's not converging in that limit. So there is some converging some converging factor that can come through the integral in every
yes,
case.
There will
can you guarantee?
Actually, we are not actually interested in this A, because this A will not actually give us many factors, because this portion is always the same almost. With this portion, there for every like for a free particle and for harmonic oscillator, more extra terms will add into this capital A. Okay, so means we have written A, but for the exact evaluation of all the systems, there you can see that the final expression will finally converge. The expression will finally converge, because you can only look into this term, because there is a whole term, the whole integration over left over here. So you have to evaluate this whole integration first, and then look the overall result. Okay.
Okay. So for any kind of
As you saw in the path integral in this suppose in the free particle case, the overall thing will obviously this is the finite answer of the transition amplitude. Okay.
Right. But can you guarantee some qualitatively? Can you guarantee that for any system it is convergent?
Qualitatively, maybe I cannot guarantee that. Maybe by looking into this formula only, maybe I cannot guarantee that for every system this will the overall integral will converge. Because one thing I told you about this convergence is because we are taking this from the Minkowski space, we are taking into the Euclidean. And that is done because one reason is because of the convergence. It is easier to converge in the Euclidean space. Okay, so maybe I cannot look into the expression and guarantee that qualitatively that this will converge in all the systems. But this will converge. I can show you some mathematical steps where you can see that this will converge. This has to converge actually.
That means the mathematical proof is there, right?
There is a mathematical proof which will show that the overall thing will converge. Overall thing will converge, because
yes,
there is an exponential
integral.
Overall thing will converge. Yes, overall thing will converge.
U
is convergent. U is obviously convergent, because or else we cannot extract physical results from there.
Okay. So.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think that answers Ashkadeep's question or Kashdeep's question. So.
Another
question
is that in the contour diagram, what was the plus minus EP? Yes,
so this K is the four momentum. Okay, so from there we can split the four momentum into the energy. Like for the four momentum, the first component is the energy part, and the rest three components are the components in the three dimensions of the momentum. So from there that EP comes. Okay. From this K, it is there in this K, in the denominator, it is already there. Okay. So because of this
so
K,
the singular
it is
points,
singular points are there.
Yes.
Okay.
That corresponds to the omega, right? The EP is corresponding to some omega. Yes,
omega. That is omega is the, or this is the harmonic oscillator frequency. That is the written in the
right.
Lagrangian we started with.
Right. So that it is like, it is the forced harmonic oscillator you are doing.
Not exactly forced. Because we kept the external source general. We kept it JT, time dependent source term. Okay. So if you want to put some expression, you can put in the J term.
Okay. No, I actually thinking that if the EP, which is the singular point, it corresponds in classical picture as a resonance. It is right or wrong conceptually?
I have not thought about that, because in the classical picture, it is a bit harder, because there we cannot define this four momentum first of all. Okay. And there this Feynman's Green's function itself will not arise. The singular points will not arise in classical picture, because we define this Feynman's Green's function from starting from transition amplitude. Okay. From there, we followed the derivations and went. So maybe this is only quantum mechanically we obtain this. Because the Green's function is itself defined quantum mechanically, Feynman's Green's function. Okay.
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 So next we have Shoporno. So Shoporno, please keep your questions precise. Okay.
Okay. So Yeah, okay, then I may ask only a few questions. So so I had a question that you use time order, right? So is this time order because we are assuming that the path in the suppose I'm drawing a diagram in a space time, so it cannot go back in time. So is that the reason for time order, right?
Okay, so this time order is one factor is that we need some, suppose it's a particle like this time order, this whole idea comes from quantum field theory. So there is a time order here because we are dealing with a particle, then we can tell that from particle is going from one time to another. And also in quantum field theory, we can deal with something called antiparticle. So for that antiparticle, we can suppose the reverse time order, like from it is coming from T2 to T1. So from there, this time order, the whole concept, it can arise from there. Like for a particle, one thing.
Wanted to know that what happens if if we assume that I mean that is allowed, right? That going back in time.
For antiparticle,
so
yes.
Like what? So like what are the?
Means not exactly going back to time, but in hello.
I think there is a network error in his. Okay, so I think. Right. So any more questions? If you can raise your hand. Okay, Abhijit Maiti has a question. Yeah, please unmute yourself. Go ahead.
So you have introduced the idea of path integral, and then you called something about vacuum to vacuum amplitude.
Yes.
And you sort of give an idea about a source acting on the vacuum and then create a particle and destroy a particle, and all of this thing came from can you get an idea, here you consider all of this thing as a particle. I mean, can you give an idea about how can we interpret this as a field from this path integral, from the kernel or the propagator?
So I think you are talking about since I've discussed the path integral in quantum mechanics, are you talking about how can we introduce in quantum field theory, in terms of fields?
Yeah.
Okay. So in terms of fields, since we are talking about here, we talked about XI, TI and everything like that. But if in quantum field theory, we generally talk about fields. So for fields, the degrees of freedom are infinite. Okay. So there, for that field, this thing will be phi, d phi. Okay. Here we separated dx1 up to dxn minus 1. And the Lagrangian that we, because we wrote the action over here in the general formula, it is the action. So we have to write the action in terms of fields, because the Lagrangian will be in terms of like in phi 4 theory. So the one term is lambda phi 4. So there phi is the field. So from there, the action will be in terms of the fields. Okay. So from there, the field thing will be there. Here the formula is quite general, but it will be d phi over here, not x, because in field theory, there is nothing called x. Means fields are dependent on xt, but we talk about fields because it is now infinite degrees of freedom we are talking about. Okay, so from there, we are talking about phi, and this action will be in terms of phi because the Lagrangian is originally in terms of phi. So does that answer your question?
Okay.
Yeah, okay, thanks a lot. So if you have any more questions, you can write in the chat box or you can raise your hand now. If not, then I have some questions and those will be the concluding questions. I don't see anything in the chat box or anyone raising hand. Okay, so Devopam, I just had a question, right?
Yes.
Okay, so as far as I have read path integrals, so this solving path integrals really boils down to essentially calculating Gaussian integrals, right?
Exactly.
So... when you solve an anaharmonic oscillator with a 5-4 potential, is there a...
X4. Means here we are talking about...
of course, we are talking about X4. So is there, certain, more generalized theorems that we can have, or do you know of any such thing where we can do higher order terms or,
So actually, these things are... it depends a lot on the systems, because you saw that in the free particle case, we could evaluate the phase factor very easily. Okay, because we had the advantage that x dot was constant. But for external source, we had to do many things we introduce something called a variation and everything. So it depends, as far as I know, it depends on the system, because the calculations can be very non-trivial depending on the systems that we are working, because depending on this Lagrangian. But I think this general method is, as far as I know, I think this variation of the path is quite general, because here we obtain, here we can solve this by method of Fourier transform and matrix method.
So that works for X4 or let's say X8, if I want include, just as curiosity.
X8, I don't know, but you can refer to the Binder and Wu paper, and you can see that the calculation is done for X4.
Okay, so there is a book by Feynman also on path integrals.
Yes,
I think. Yeah.
Yes.
You can refer to that. Okay, so Sudipto has a question, and then Shopano has one last question. So Sudipto, please unmute yourself and keep your questions precise. Thanks.
Hello.
Yes. Hello.
Can you go to the slide, the Euclidean time, where do you put tau is
Euclidean by t? Time. Okay, wait. Euclidean time. Yes, here.
So, in quantum mechanics, like suppose a particle at position x1, at time t1, it is going to at x2 and t2. So all the paths are possible with some Wittes factor, right? I mean, in quantum mechanics.
In finite path integral, yes.
In quantum mechanics. So now here you are putting the real time tau with some IT, right?
How this
is related to the physical system? I mean, from real time to you're going some I times the imaginary time. Is it the space-like event or?
No, we actually rotate the time axis. Okay, means I, as we know from complex numbers, as we know that I, if we multiply something by I, then the axis rotates. Okay, so
yeah, although 90 degrees.
So although we calculate every, means it is easier for us to calculate in Euclidean time, but the final result that we will represent, that we will never keep it in terms of Euclidean time. We will always bring it down to Minkowski time. So one way you can think is that it is maybe easier to calculate in Euclidean time.
Just to make calculation easy. Not exactly
calculation, means you can think of that picture. Like in GR also, we take a, there is a picture that where we take the time component as I times the temporal component, ICT. If you explain that, so that their negative sign can be explained, like I square it becomes, so minus sign comes from there. So similarly, here also you can maybe think of that in that way, like in GR. So there is a I factor is there, and you can write that temporal component as ICT in that way. So you can think that over here. But main reason I can tell you is that to remove this I and to remove the oscillatory part of this integral, because oscillation is always difficult to deal with.
The
limits are adjusted for that.
Okay, so I have another more question. So can you go to the slide at Borel sum? I mean, where do you?
Borel sum.
Yeah, the convergence of series. Where you were talking about the convergence of series?
This slide. Convergence of series. This is a
Borel. No. I mean, then you said that 1/n². For this term, I think if we divide it by 1/n, 1/n², I think these three terms is converging, right? I mean, maybe it is the case that later it will diverge, but...
Later, because for the divergent terms, we may remove the first finite terms, few finite terms. Okay, so when a series is diverging, then we are actually interested in the latter half, and the first terms will not actually give us some, means it will obviously contribute to the final result, but it will not give us like anything very physical. So the latter terms will surely diverge. Okay. Means I mentioned
only about A2/A0 and A3/A0, there is a large difference. So it is possible that it is exponentially increasing like that.
I don't know exactly how this is increasing, but the latter terms are like, it is very large, means it will increase rapidly because you can see this difference in this term.
Okay.
So that will not be encountered by that n term which is divided by.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, so Shopano had a question. Shopano?
Yeah, so I'm being precise. So, Devapam, I have a question related to this summation of divergent series. So this again, Borel and Euler. So basically, the problem is, like there are few series which actually matches in both Borel and Einstein in Euler. So like 1 - 1 + 1 - 1 is half in both cases. But as you said here that for asymptotic series, Borel only works, that never works. So I mean, but these divergent series, these are like very like it's a convention, no? You can have the same series give you different results according to different summation conventions. So how to understand which one is which one actually caters to my problem? I've seen this series, but I don't understand that when. Okay, I'll say that this is the problem, so I'll use Borel. This is the problem, I'll use Euler. So that.
So there, in that case, the answer is here over in the first line. Okay. So you told that Borel and Euler matches. So or Borel works only means Euler will not be applicable when An grows faster than powers of N. Okay. So this type of summation technique, it has certain constraints. It works when something like Borel works when An grows faster than powers of N. There is something called generalized Borel summation. It works for its own, I don't exactly remember the constraint over here. So every summation works depending on the constraint. Okay, so if there is a series, if a series is given to you, first you need to check the terms, which terms it is satisfying which of the constraints of the summation techniques. Depending on the constraint which is of the summation technique which your given series is satisfying, you go with that summation technique. Okay.
I'm understanding. Just a minute. The thing I was asking, there are problems like where you actually have to subtract two infinite quantities, right, to find out some positive value. So there you see, suppose I'm having a series, 1 - 1/2 + 1/3 - 1/4, which converges to log 2. But if I rearrange this series, that gives me half log 2. So that is my question was at that point. So how in such problems, means what is the constraint? What do we choose? Means how do we understand that? Okay, that I have to arrange it this in such a way that I get this result. That is what I was asking. Like, how do we understand that? Okay, yeah, I'm understanding your this constraint that obviously I can Euler wouldn't converge for A in this growing not fast. So I was asking that in problems where you have problems arising because of rearrangement, what do you do there? Rearrangement or this kind of series, like multiple results just on your choice of convention. So what do you do there? That was the question.
I understood the question. I can rephrase it in this way. Like if there is a series like 1 - 1 + 1 - 1 like this. So if I club all that plus one terms together and take all the minus one terms club all the minus one separately, then we will obtain some results. And if we club two plus one together and minus one separately, then we will obtain another result. This type of where we are actually doing the rearranging of this oscillatory series, that can read in Erskine. As far as I remember, I don't think that it is related over here, but as far as I remember in Erskine, it is given that when an oscillatory series is given, you cannot rearrange in your own will. Okay.
Right. Yes.
It is given like 1 - 1 + 1 - 1 + 1 - 1. Then you need to keep the series as 1 + 1 - 1 + 1 - 1. You cannot, because this is oscillatory and you don't have the liberty to take all the plus one to one side and all the minus one to one side. Okay, in these of series where there is a chance of rearranging, there you cannot, and the series which is given after, I have not read, but I can predict that after, since you cannot rearrange, and since the general term you know An, from there you can same constraint idea that you can see which constraint. But as well, I think the question is depending on whether we can rearrange or not, and in which cases we can rearrange. But which cases we can rearrange. But as far as I remember, in Erskine it was clearly written that in research for oscillatory series we cannot rearrange the summations. Okay, we need to keep it. But I can discuss with you. Okay, after the talk, I can discuss with you in which cases maybe we can rearrange. I have to read it about it.
Okay.
Thank you, Shobhana. Thank you, Devabom. I don't think we have any more time for questions. So I think that brings us to a close. So thanks a lot, Devabom, for this very interesting talk. And I do have some questions which I'll ask you personally.
Yes, anyone over here, whoever is present, they can ask me in Facebook if they have, because I can understand that I skip many steps. But actually, in this limited time, I was not able to show all those steps of the calculation. Absolutely.
Yes, sure.
So anyone can ask me about all the questions.
So just that point on Facebook. So we have our Facebook page. So yeah, please go ahead and like that page. And we are also opening a YouTube channel. So all these videos that are here will be uploaded there as well. So yeah, thank you everyone. So I hope you are all doing well. And let's end this session tonight.